Helmer, thank you, first of all, thank you for making time. I know you're a busy man. Before we get into this, I know you are a part owner, maybe not at all, of a small business that is probably struggling. So if you're in Vacaville, if you want to give a shout out to the business.
Well, one, I appreciate it again that you're having me on. You know, it's an honor to be on. You know, it's awesome. Yes, we are a small business owner. No, we are not struggling.
No,
You know, we've been blessed. My wife does an amazing job at running it.
Mm-hmm.
She has built that thing from the ground up, you know, with my support,
mm-hmm.
but that is her baby. And she has really done a great job, and she has taken some hard line stances,
mm-hmm.
and some people have really appreciated it, and some people have not really appreciated it. But nevertheless, there's principles that we choose not to budge on.
Yeah.
And I think people really value that. So Eco Chic is the name of the small business. And it's, like I said, we have a strong community that support us. And really that's what it's about, is community.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my wife wanted to start it out as a resource for the community at the worst possible time. When we started the business, short story, I actually ruptured my Achilles playing basketball.
Oh man.
not the greatest of timing, but she had the faith to start it, and it's better than it's ever been. So yeah. During uncertain times, it's been pretty solid.
So she's doing from your words, she's been doing a really good job managing.
Absolutely.
And she has a good backup savings plan for a year like this.
Yeah, she has navigated through the madness very well. A lot of favor on the business.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she's done really well.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So she's doing her business thing, growing her baby, Eco Chic, Vacaville, California.
Nut Tree, right across the street from the carousel.
Nut Tree Plot. Oh, I'm sure a lot of people, if you're listening and you're in California, period, driving by Nut Tree, you probably know
absolutely
exactly where that's at.
Man, appreciate the plug, my man. Thank you.
Hey, for sure. This is what it's all about. Because I'm sure there's other small businesses that are struggling,
absolutely.
You know, and sometimes they don't know why.
Yeah.
And it could be maybe better management, better budgeting, or two, just principles. You know, being principled and not allowing somebody else to dictate how you run your business and live your life, pretty much.
Yeah. You know, one of the main successes that she has really had is she found her niche.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she found her niche and she ran with that. She went with that and it expanded. And again, she really didn't budge from her core belief system.
Mm-hmm.
And really, it really did turn into a resource where she's been a blessing to the community, but also has honored God with the finances as well.
Mm-hmm.
And it really has been, it's been a success so far.
So reaping what she sows, pretty
absolutely.
Much.
Absolutely.
That's awesome.
Absolutely.
So you yourself are in a management position as well,
mm-hmm.
For a drywall contractor. Your official title is a superintendent, general superintendent?
I'm an area superintendent.
Area superintendent.
Yes, sir.
That's the official title. The non-official title is like what? Psychologist, friend maker, peacemaker.
Truth teller,
babysitter. What else? What else? What else?
You know, I think the one thing out of everything you just listed is probably truth teller.
Truth teller.
Absolutely.
You listed that one.
I'm a big truth teller. You know, I like to, I think, you know, we're all grownups,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's, you know, we kind of touched on this a little bit earlier in regards to, you know, work is work.
Yeah.
If I got to wake up every day and spend time around human beings all day long,
mm-hmm.
you know, then it's about the relationships. And I think the relationships are only as strong as your ability to tell them the truth, as well as receive the truth. You know, I think it's very important to let people know where they stand,
mm-hmm.
good, bad, middle of the road, as well as I also think that it's important for those people to feel safe coming to you and sharing where they're coming from as well. Mm-hmm. And I often feel like if they're willing to come to you and share with you how they're feeling, then they're also willing to hear, you know, the other end of that as well, you know? Okay. So yeah, I would say truth teller is probably the strongest line in there that you just mentioned.
Okay. So that's crazy because usually when somebody thinks of superintendent in construction, they're thinking blueprints, they're thinking a lot of other stuff besides truth teller.
Yeah.
So one of the most interesting things that people say the most in what they're most interested in a career is somebody's day schedule, like what their schedule is like from morning to evening. Can we talk about yours?
Sure.
What's that like?
It's a full day. I mean, there's times where getting phone calls 4:30 in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, emails, phone calls, you know, sometimes 7 to 8 o'clock at night, sometimes Sunday afternoons, Saturday mornings, calls, emails, you know, people got to get in contact with you. You know, your clients, your customer base, you know, needs to be making sure they're taken care of, establishing on a daily basis, you know, your walk-in jobs, making sure that, you know, schedules are being met, budgets are being met. Mm-hmm. You are hearing complaints from people, whether that be a customer, a client, or guys you're working around, guys you're working with, you know, problem solving, as well as, you know, offering advice on a daily. Sometimes there's office meetings day in and day out, building and establishing relationships with clients, with other companies, you know, in order to share manpower, give manpower, in order to keep your core busy. There's a number of things that go into it. I would consider, you know, some of my strengths in, you know, the relationship building. I came from a drywall finishing aspect of things. So I know, you know, finishes from drywall on really well. One of the weaknesses I have is, you know, the mechanics of the trade, you know, the constructability, but that's where you really rely on, or I myself rely on, man, my team. We have such a great team, you know, at our company. You know, a lot of a bright, young up-and-comers, guys that have been around a long time. And man, you're only as good as the team around you. You know, period. You're only as strong as the relationships you have within your own company.
LeBron can't learn that. How come LeBron doesn't learn that part of the?
Hey,
or would you disagree?
You know what? That guy's won multiple championships.
Yeah,
he's definitely not the GOAT. I'll give that to Michael Jordan.
Okay,
but man, he knows a little bit of something about something. He's doing something right.
He knows something we don't know.
Yeah.
So, okay.
Yeah.
So I would agree with you 100% where you mentioned one of your strengths is relationship building. In construction, too often foremen will try to take credit for something bad and push off, blame somebody else take credit for something good, blame somebody else for something bad.
Yeah.
Obviously, you've been a leadman, you've been a regular foreman, you've ran your own projects, now you're an area superintendent, and each of those levels is a different level of almost emotional intelligence or knowledge that can make or break a relationship. So I'm sure there's going to be other guys listening to us that want your job, right? Or want a job like yours, and they think they have everything to be a general foreman, or they think they have everything to be a superintendent because they know how to refill a chalk box and the way they draw their crow's foot when they lay out or whatever. But a lot of it has so much more to do with so much more. So one example, and then you could kind of go off to wherever you want to go from there, is the first thing that comes to mind is there's an issue with the GC and a foreman. As a superintendent, you're trying to keep a relationship with the GC, but also back up your foreman, mm-hmm. right? Because the last thing you want to do is the foreman to feel like you don't have his back. And so how do you approach a situation like that without keeping both relationships at the end of the day?
Well, obviously every situation is different, right?
Correct.
So it's really tough to...
This is a hypothetical, so yes.
Yeah, so it's a little bit tough to address that specific circumstance okay. and paint it with a broad brush. Mm-hmm. That being said, I got to work with our team mm-hmm. day in and day out for the foreseeable future.
Correct.
You know, so for the most part, I'm going to listen because I have a relationship with my team. Mm-hmm. I'm probably going to
trust.
Trust what my team is saying first mm-hmm. and then hear what the customer and client is saying as well. You know, you try and remain level-headed, be as objective as possible. Mm-hmm. But I think one of the biggest things is be a good listener. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to hear what the customer or client is saying. You know, you got to hear what your team is saying, you know, and assess every specific situation at hand and address that as it comes up.
Okay.
You know, again, the relationship that we have with within our own team mm-hmm. is number one priority for me, mm-hmm. for myself. That's mm-hmm. the number one. That is the number one, you know, from, you know, that's promoting within, establishing trust with our team, supporting our team, quite honestly, promoting our team. Mm-hmm. There are people more qualified than myself to hold the position that I have. Mm-hmm. You know, but I'm in the position that I'm in. I've worked hard to get where I'm at. You know, that being said, I'm in the position I'm in. And I'd like to think that, you know, mostly everybody respects where I'm at mm-hmm. Because of the relationship and because of the trust that's been established with everybody. Mm-hmm. They know I'm on their team. They know I'm going to go to bat for them at all times.
See, it's a little different because you have the luxury, I want to say, of being part of a team for many years. Many times, especially these type of, I guess, executive field positions. I mean, oftentimes these positions are being filled, void, filled, void, filled, void, filled, void. Right. So it is definitely a benefit, I guess, to your position, having these established long-term relationships already from the bat. Many superintendents, foremen don't have that. What is the, in your opinion, what is the best way to develop a relationship with a team member in the field? And I guess we're focusing a little bit more on the field right now, because I feel like this is a very important topic, no matter what kind of contractor you are. Just being in a management position in a trade, on a project, this kind of goes for everybody.
So just to address, you know, something you said about having the luxury of really having some of the same team from the beginning. Mm-hmm. We really haven't. Mm-hmm. We've really undergone a lot of changes as a team over the last, you know, between, you know, 4 to 5 years. Mm-hmm. There are a few guys that, you know, definitely have worked around for a long time. And really, I would say that one of the secrets to our success is, man, we're friends first, you know? And so it's a little bit easier to receive the truth from them as well as give the truth to them. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so we're able to move past some things quicker. We've worked hard to establish the culture that we have now. It's really been a conscious decision to change some of that culture. We have not always had the healthiest of cultures. Mm-hmm. And I would say that in the industry as a whole, you do come across every man for themselves, even within their own companies. Mm-hmm. You have one guy trying to step on another guy's back to get up to a higher position. And I'm not saying that we are completely absent from that. Mm-hmm. You know, there's probably still a little bit of that goes on, and that's there's a little bit of human element of that.
They and everyone knows for themselves, they know who they are.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? So there's an element of that that's still a little bit disappointing. At the same time, you know, just to address some of our situation, mm-hmm. you know, we've worked hard. We've made the conscious decision to have a different culture, establish a different culture. And that's really what it comes down to, is a culture where the next guy can trust the next guy, you know, where there's an open, you know, where people are open, they're honest, and we're cultivating a culture to all push in the same direction. Mm-hmm. You know, we're all swimming the same direction. We all got the same goals in mind. And we've been fortunate enough to really have a lot of support from upper management mm-hmm. on the upper management level to really proceed in this direction. And I think that a lot of that is reflected in the results we've had. We've been extremely successful in the results we've had, relationally first, monetarily second, because of the culture that's been created, mm-hmm. because of the culture that's been being established and cultivated over the last few years.
Right.
So, you know, to your point, one of the big things that we really made a point to do is to promote people within, mm-hmm. To recognize the hard work that they've put in. It's not about who you know, but it's about the quality of job that you're doing, quality of job that you're, you know, producing day in and day out. Are you trustworthy? Mm-hmm. You know, can we trust you with dollars and cents? But more importantly, can we trust you with the relationships that you're working around? You know, are you going to suffocate people and keep them down, or are you going to promote people? And we're big on promoting people. We're mm-hmm. big on, you know, we do not want leadership in a place of leadership if they're insecure about their position, you know, because I believe that insecurity breeds suffocation. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're secure in who you are and you're secure in the job that you're doing, then you're going to promote other people, and that's going to cultivate other people. You know, there's going to be hope in other people to do the best job possible, because they're going to get recognized eventually.
Yes.
And rewarded for the job that they're able to do.
I have a perfect example of this. Back when I was an apprentice, I think first or second period, this was with like a small job in Sacramento. I was working with this guy named Todd, longest whiskers. And he told me, hey, kid, I'm going to teach you almost everything I know. I was like, why is that? He said, because if I teach you everything, then I'm going to lose my job.
Yeah.
And so I went in and literally the next day I talked to my foreman. I was like, I don't think I want to work with this guy. He's not really interested in making his apprentice better.
Yeah.
And so that I will forever remember that, and always try, like in my personal life, whatever it is, work or anything, not to be that guy that is trying to, like you said, suffocate, you know, someone.
Well, the first red flag should have been his name was Todd. I mean, my man, right out the gate, we got a Todd. And yeah. You should have gone to your foreman then.
I didn't know.
Yeah, now you know.
Now I know. Let me get some. So I'm sure you come across this oftentimes, where a leadman or a journeyman thinks he's ready to be a foreman.
Oh yeah.
And he's fighting for whatever it is. So, you know, some of them don't care for anything, just the job title.
Yeah.
What are some things that you would recommend that person? Say it's Todd.
Yeah.
Say Todd wants to be a foreman. And what are a couple things that you would tell Todd that, like, hey, these are the few things that you should probably check in yourself, or these are the skills. Obviously, there needs to be skills mechanically, but then obviously there also needs to be emotional skills.
Yeah. Well, first, just for me, there's a little bit of a vetting system in place for us. Mm-hmm. I really trust, again, back to the trust thing, right? Mm-hmm. I really trust who we have at a leadership position. Mm-hmm. They've spent years working for us, and so I've gotten to know them day in and day out. Mm-hmm. I trust their decision-making skills. I trust their ability to, quite honestly, discern some of the personality traits with who they're working around on a day in and day out basis. Mm-hmm. And so there's a little bit of a vetting process in place as far as who some of the people are that are requesting more responsibility, which comes with more pay, which comes with titles and that. And so I will always defer to our field leadership team. Mm-hmm. I will always talk to them first, like, hey, what do you think about person A or person B? Quite honestly, I get quite a bit of, I'd say probably once every few weeks, I get either a call from another company mm-hmm. of guys wanting to come over. Hey, they can run this job or that job. I get guys within our own team saying, hey, I'm, whether they're a lead man, hey, I'm ready to be a foreman, or mm-hmm. foreman, hey, I'm ready to be a superintendent, or, you know, journeyman, hey, I'm ready to run work. You know, so we always get quite honestly, we get quite a bit of people that are always feel like they're ready for
the next
that
step.
Next level. Mm-hmm. But I will always defer to our field management first, because they're working around these guys day in and day out. Mm-hmm. Now, if I've known a guy a long time and they are requesting more responsibility, then I'll be brutally honest with them. I'll mm-hmm. say, hey, look, we need to see, you know, for example, we've got a kid that works for us, mm-hmm. great hand, knows the trade, you know, lot of potential. Mm-hmm. Potential only gets you so far, though. Mm-hmm. You know, it just so happens that, man, he gets his car stolen, he gets sick, he's got a doctor's appointment every Friday or every Monday.
Yeah.
So it just so happens that some of this always works out.
Truthfully.
He's got a 3-day weekend. You know, and so I was brutally honest with him.
Yeah.
And I told him, I go, my man, what makes me feel like you're going to be able to be reliable once you get a leadership position if you're not reliable at a journeyman level? Mm-hmm. You know, and so I think that if people can show that they're responsible with the little mm-hmm. and they can take care of the little bit, mm-hmm. you know, it's principle, then we'll trust you with a little bit more, mm-hmm. you know? And so that's big for me. Day in and day out, are you reliable? Day in and day out, are you responsible? You know, and work, you know, work ethic's big. Are you a master of your craft? Do you do good work? Do you care about your appearance? You know, because all of that is representation of the companies you're working for. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So those are big ones.
Okay, so that's a lot more than just knowing how to lay out or knowing
Absolutely.
how to run a couple guys.
How you treat people? How you treat people is a big one.
How you treat?
We have some of the most. In the past, we've had some of the most skilled labor force, mm-hmm. complete D-bags, you know? And so we have screamers, yellers, cursers. We've had people that will disrespect you up and down. Matter of fact, it's funny. We were talking about one guy today. Mm-hmm. Man, knowledgeable guy, respected guy. Mm-hmm. Treated people like garbage, mm-hmm. you know? And so ultimately, you know, the results in the end were okay. They could have been a lot better if he would have just treated people the correct way. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, now I think there is that line where you don't want people walking all over you and that, but I think that you get a lot more with honey than you do with vinegar, you know? And so treating people is a big one.
For yeah. us. Yeah. So I, that comparison that you brought up, you get a lot more with honey. And drawing a line, because even honey like can be contained, you know, mm-hmm. in a jar, or you put a border around honey and it doesn't overflow. And this kind of takes me back to what you said about being honest or truthful. Mm-hmm. You can have a good relationship with somebody and still be honest with them and say, hey, look, this is a line for me, like though we don't cross. Like I am at this, for example, position, right, where I'm not demanding respect from you or whatever, but this is where things change. We are, for example, friends outside of work, mm-hmm. but at work, like this has to be a working environment and we have to kind of keep the company's interests.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. That's quite honestly, my man, that's been the biggest challenge within the position that I have. Mm-hmm. My best friends in life, mm-hmm. we work with each other. And there has been some tough conversations. And quite honestly, I've had to let go of friends because they really weren't performing. Now, there was honest conversations had with some of these people. They were given opportunities to be better.
Reflect.
Reflect, change. And they, some of these people made the decisions to not do so. And so at that point, you know, those issues have to be addressed and I have a job to do. On my end, there's no hard feelings that they didn't take it serious. That I was quite honestly put in a position to have to let them go. I wish it would have never come to that. But at the end of the day, I think that anybody who has any kind of pride in what they do,
integrity,
absolutely, integrity, strong character, you know, those types of things, then it's really a non-issue. That being said, again, relationships are of the utmost importance. Again, I work with the best friends that I have in life. But I would say 99% of the time it's a non-issue because I really have chosen to surround myself with strong character people, you know, men of integrity, people of integrity. And so it's really been a non-issue for the most part. Now, there's been disagreements on jobs and disagreements happen all the time. You know, we're grownups. We can disagree. We can agree to disagree and we move on, you know? So disagree. I think disagreements will happen. They'll continue to happen. I mean, damn, happens with my wife.
Right.
You know, we got to move on and hey.
Exactly.
No harm, no foul.
It's not about the disagreement, but if you're intelligent enough to come out of the disagreement with a solution or better than you came into it, well, then that just makes everyone's world a little better.
Disagreement's healthy, I think.
Yeah, 100%.
I think disagreement's healthy a lot of times. Agreed. I think within our own team, you know, my boss, you know, we have a different approach.
Yeah.
Quite honestly, a starkly different approach. And I would say that there are times where he is right. It pains me.
Yeah.
But he's right, man. We need to go that direction. And there's other times where I'm right. But there really is a healthy balance there. You know, there's a balance. He's very, you know, he's experienced, he's seasoned, he's phenomenal at the mechanics and the building of the projects. And I'm probably more, and I think he would admit that I'm stronger on the relational side of things, on the, you know, the day in and day out operations. He's really strong in the administration side of things. And so we really have found a balance that works for us. I think that, again, I think there's a lot of positives that can come out of disagreements. As long as you have good listeners. You know, disagreement becomes a dangerous spot to be in when you don't have good listeners.
Everybody's but if you just have yelling.
If you have flexible people that are willing to listen, disagreement's healthy.
Okay, so what is the best way to groom a young foreman without spoiling him? Him or her, I mean, because I know more and more there's women on the job sites now.
Absolutely.
That's another topic.
Yeah, I don't know if we want to address that topic today, but we've actually...
HR is not here, so we won't talk about it.
So we actually, for years, we did not do that well at all. You know, like I referenced in the beginning of, you know, our conversation, the last 3 to 5 years, we've undergone a big culture change. And a lot of it was because we didn't really have, I guess, for lack of better terms, a minor league system. You know, we had our main players and there was nobody below that. And so when we went underwent some of the changes we went under, we had a number of people that left that had been here a long time. And it really left us in an unfortunate predicament at the time. That being said, it really forced some people to step up to the plate. It helped us. It made it easier for us to promote people that maybe we didn't feel like we were quite ready yet. Maybe we were overanalyzing the situation. But it helped us develop a minor league system. And so what I think for us, it's been important for us to put some of our younger guys with some of our really strong players.
Okay.
You know, but again, I think that that is all decided within the people that you choose to put into leadership positions. Because if some of the, like, you know, like we talked about earlier, I get calls from guys from other companies that say they can run 50 people. They can run $20 million worth of work. Mm-hmm. They can do A, they can do B, you know, and I just like to listen. You know, I like to listen. I like to hear what they have to say. And then I just start asking questions. Mm-hmm. You know, I think you can tell a lot in a person if you just ask questions.
The right questions.
And you're willing to listen. And a lot of times, quite honestly, they'll expose themselves, good and bad. Mm-hmm. And so I think I'm big on picking the people. Mm-hmm. I think if you pick the right people, everything else can be taught. And we've been blessed and we've been fortunate enough to have and to choose the right people. Now, has that been fail-proof? Absolutely not. I would say, but we do have a pretty darn good track record mm-hmm. in the people that we've chosen. And it has been reflected in the results. We are very fortunate with the people that we have. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. We're very fortunate in the relationships that have been established. So blessed in that area.
So another crazy part is, and we touched about it this little bit, the guy that shows up 3 days a week.
Yeah.
It kind of blows my mind that today in this age, the easiest way to keep a job is to show up every day. There is a huge, I think, shortage of men in these fields. One, two, a huge shortage of capable men to show up every day. Mm-hmm. So I know you're a father and your boys, and I'm sure they have greater plans than to work for than work in as a drywaller or whatever, but there's certain values in life that take you anywhere. It doesn't matter what you do. So as a father, how do you kind of almost preach or instill into your kids, your boys?
Yeah.
To develop these skills of one, integrity, trust, and especially in this day and age, 2020, where a family is undervalued oftentimes, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Man, I don't know if there's enough time in the evening to discuss all that, but I guess, you know, we'll touch a little bit on that.
Yes.
Because there are some deep-rooted foundational issues there. I have three kids. Mm-hmm. You know, my oldest is 18. He just turned 18. I got another teenage boy who's 15, and my little girl that's 10. And, you know, I've been tough on my boys. Mm-hmm. You know,
obviously being tough on your boys doesn't mean you beat them or you deprive them of having fun or enjoying life.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. But I really have tried to instill in them accountability, ownership, honesty, and really biblical foundational principles. Mm-hmm, you mm-hmm. know, there was my dad growing up was extremely hard on me. Mm-hmm. Military background. And he tried to manage those things as a father the best that he knew how at the time. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Growing up, it was a challenge because I didn't understand. I thought,
what he's trying to get across.
Absolutely. Really tough. Looking back now, I can appreciate and I value the principles that he instilled in me. Mm-hmm. During the course of that training session, though, it was not always appreciated or valued.
Yeah.
And so I remember even last year, you know, I'm 41 now. Mm-hmm. I know I don't look it.
No, you look like 36.
Hey, I'll take that all day. You know, it's funny, bro. I've gotten 54.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've gotten 54.
I've also gotten 32. So I'm going to fall somewhere in the middle of that. So,
what?
Yeah.
54 and 42?
Yeah. And 32.
Okay, 32.
Yeah.
Okay.
But
54, dang.
Yeah.
Someone must not be
41.
Yeah, 41. Okay. On the record.
Yeah. So all that being said, you know, I couldn't always value or appreciate what my dad was doing. But I remember going over his house, I believe it was last year. Mm-hmm. And we were, going through some struggles, you know, with our teenage son, being a typical teenager. And man, my wife and I, we figured, man, we're phenomenal parents. You know, we're trying to do things a little bit differently than we did before.
We're perfect.
But we're human beings.
Yeah.
You know, and everybody's on their own journey and path. And I went to my dad and I told him I really appreciated all the foundational principles he was trying to instill in me at the time. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't value them until later on in life. And I believe that that's going to happen with, you know, our kids as well. They can't mm-hmm. fully appreciate, you know, what some of the times that I'm tough on them, mm-hmm. you know, right now. And so again, ownership, accountability, honesty, and just biblical foundational principles we are consistently and constantly trying to apply to them. And quite honestly, you know, stand up for what you believe in. You know, stand up firm for what you believe in. I think right now we're living in a time where, quite honestly, people are blindly following right, wrong, left, right. This isn't no statement in any direction, mm-hmm. but I think that you have to stand firm on your foundational core belief system, you know, and we really try and instill that in our boys and man, be good listeners, be open, be objective. You know, at the same time, you have your core belief system mm-hmm. and stand firm in that, you know? And so we've really tried to instill that in our boys and they are strong personalities, you know, and their mama has mm-hmm. a strong personality and their daddy has a strong personality. So yeah. You can imagine some of the dynamics.
Bunch of alphas in the house.
Yeah, absolutely. And my little girl's probably got the strongest personality out of us all.
Yeah.
You know, nevertheless, it creates some interesting dynamics. But we're trying to raise up strong adults, not just strong children.
So yeah, sometimes, you know, you can always appreciate a strong personality. You can also always appreciate, I think, any type of personality, because like when I look at all my siblings and there was 9 of us growing up and each one is so different and has a certain strength and has a certain weakness. And I'm like, one time I'm thinking like, God, like why would we need to be so different if I'm imagining this type of person is the only successful person?
Yeah.
But in reality, each strength you have, if you know how to direct that energy,
yeah,
how to use that strength in life, will get you successful. If you're a quiet, meek person naturally, you would be surprised how many successful, quiet, meek people there are.
Yeah.
If you're a loud, obnoxious, crazy dude, you would be surprised how many successful, crazy, loud, obnoxious people there are.
Yeah.
Well,
how do you define success? Isn't success objective?
We're digging deep. Yeah,
absolutely. And so, you know, I would probably define success a little bit different than maybe you would define success. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure every human being has a little small different variation of what success looks like.
Right. I mean, if when I was 19, I would tell you success is I got myself a Hellcat and the brand new, what's those $20,000 new Nikes that came out, whatever. kids are all into buying yeah. and selling shoes now.
Yeah.
But now for me, success is, when I got married, success was for me is like, okay, can I provide for my family? Now success for me is, can I raise my kids right? If I raise my kids right,
absolutely,
dude, I feel like I've accomplished so much in my life.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? Yeah, those dynamics definitely change as we grow up and mature a little bit. I'm with you. You know, in my youth, I had a different version of success then than what I do now.
Yeah.
And I was making a lot less money then than I am now.
Right.
You know, but those levels, that definition of success has definitely changed through the years, you know, especially as you have kids, you become provider and protector and, you know, husband and father and, you know, all those different titles change. I think some of that vision of what success looks like definitely changes. I know it, you know, sounds like it has for you. It definitely mm-hmm. has for me.
Is there a secret way? Because what I'm trying to like, sometimes you talk to an 18-year-old kid yeah. and like, dude, this homie's lost. Well, and then other times you talk to an 18-year-old kid and you're like, how did this guy, like, yeah. how does everything make sense, whatever he's saying?
Absolutely. You know, it's funny that, I mean, that's my oldest son in a microcosm. I mean, in a bubble right there.
Yeah.
There are things that he says. He's got a business sense, business savvy, where I'm like, man, wise beyond your years, my man. And there's other things he does, and I'm like, my man, your sister is 10 times smarter than you.
Yeah.
You know, my little girl is smart, but she should not be light years ahead of him either right now.
Yeah.
And so there's definitely things, man. And he's always, I guess for lack of better terms, played up, as well as he's always been a little ahead of his time as far as years go. But yeah, I mean, as an 18-year-old.
Is it because of his height?
Yeah. It's almost 6'5". There are some things, you know, as an 18-year-old, I know I was there where, man, I had life figured out. And there's some things, there's some seasoning that's going to be coming in his life. And we'll be there to help him out with that.
Yeah. He doesn't. See, he might not think that he might need a shoulder to cry on just yet.
Oh, yeah.
But it comes to everybody, husband, wife, in a relationship. I think, like you said, arguments and disagreements, those are some of the things that develop the best relationships between a husband and wife.
Yeah.
Arguments and disagreements. And if you know how to approach them and resolve them. Back to the field. The best way you can build yourself a career as if you're a journeyman apprentice looking to be a foreman and or higher up, I think one of the best things for yourself is to learn, one, to listen, to be honest, and know how to resolve every situation. Yes, there might not be a solution today. You know, you're caught up in some one drama or just an issue in the field.
Yeah.
Don't get caught up in the moment of trying to prove yourself to somebody.
Yeah.
Like you said, use your team.
Yeah.
Use your team as a resource, not as, I can't go ask them a question. They're going to think I'm a fool.
Yeah.
You know, like, I'm sure they're gonna come and ask you something that they might not know. And that is one of the best feelings when you do have that relationship in a team, where you can ask each other, learn off of each other, build off of each other, and develop that relationship. What, why, and how can I, why did you, or how did you end up being in drywall? Not a popular thing. Everyone's trying to learn to code right now.
Yeah.
Even though San Francisco's going under the water with all this real estate.
Well, I got started. My father-in-law was a carpenter. I was working, you know, in town with a buddy of mine who owned his own construction company. And I knew a little bit about a lot of things, but I wasn't skilled in one trade. And so my father-in-law got me into the industry. It was kind of like top secret. I didn't want people to know he was my father-in-law. And my father-in-law didn't want anybody to know that I was his son-in-law. It was like, look, I'll get your foot in the door and then you sink or swim on your own. And that's the way I preferred it. I remember the first week I was there, I believe it was like the second or third day, I remember walking up some exterior scaffolding. And out loud, I said, what the hell am I doing here? I never envisioned myself doing that.
Yeah.
But I, at the time, we had just had our oldest son. And it was sink or swim. It was like, man, I got to provide for my family. And I'm an extremely driven person when I want to succeed at something. And so it was one of those things where like, man, I got to do this. It really isn't a plan B. And so, man, I started out at the very bottom, you know, fire tape and electrical rooms, you know, not knowing anything about anything. I mean, I did not have any knowledge of the trade at all. I picked up what I could as fast as I could, worked as hard as I could to be better than the next guy. I'm an extremely competitive person. If I didn't know something real well, then I had no problem asking somebody.
But there was no YouTube. You couldn't YouTube.
Easy, my man. I said I'm 41, not 72. But you're right. You're right.
No, was, yeah, YouTube, you're right. Like YouTube started in like 2007 or
yeah. Or no, 8. I mean that's a valid point. You know, but at the time, like one of the biggest things is for me is if I don't know something, I'm gonna ask.
Yeah.
You know, there's really no shame in my game as far as, man, I don't know everything.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of freedom in just saying, man, I don't know. You know? And so that's what I did. I picked apart what I didn't know. There's different foremen that did it different ways. I picked and choose what worked best for me. Mm-hmm. I applied certain things and it worked. And again, I wanted to be better than the next guy. I didn't want to give anybody a reason to let me go, lay me off. And honestly, man, there was a lot of good people getting laid off around me mm-hmm. because they didn't know the right person. And that really drove me to really be intentional about creating the culture about, it's not who you know, it's about what you do. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody's got a mouth to feed at home. Everybody's got to return home to a family, a loved one, and say, man, I got laid off, or man, I got a promotion, or mm-hmm. or whatever. It's about, that's what it's about.
That's so true. I've heard time and time again where guys will complain about the fact they got laid off and whoever's left on the job site is like the crew, even though they suck at what they do.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like the foreman's boys.
Yeah.
And they still have a job and these people get laid off. And there's times where I understand that. Like, okay, you have a huge job. There's 250 people. You need labor. You need manpower.
Yeah.
So you're kind of taking whoever you can. And I guess you could take on the boys that suck.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. But if you're down to 15, 10 guys, a good foreman and a good superintendent general foreman will keep, one, the job in mind, two, the company in mind, because he's keeping his own job in mind.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? Absolutely. I mean, there's a lot of truth in what you're saying. One of the toughest decisions that I made early on when I first started running work was I had just got a promotion actually to a general foreman position. Mm-hmm. And the superintendent at the time had come to me and asked me what I thought about a number of foremen that were working for us at the time. Went to bat for him, said, man, don't lay off anybody. You know, let's just see how the kind of the cards fall and play out. Well, we had, at the time, we had a journeyman working with us, and he'd mm-hmm. gone with me on a couple of different big jobs, and he'd kind of bounced around from company to company, but this dude was legit, mm-hmm. legit. And I remember giving him a little responsibility on a weekend, mm-hmm. and he knocked it out of the park. I'm like, man, there's something to this dude. And I remember thinking to myself, how has this dude bounced around from multiple companies for multiple years? Mm-hmm. I didn't understand it. I didn't get it. He didn't speak great English at the time. Mm-hmm. But at the time, I went to bat for him to make him a lead man. Mm-hmm. Made him a lead man, and he couldn't believe it. He's like, man, I can't believe this. You know,
grateful.
Absolutely. Grateful. And quite honestly, he was driven to prove that the decision or the me vouching for him mm-hmm. was the right one. Mm-hmm. And this dude just excelled at everything we gave him responsibility for. And so again, like we talked about earlier, you give somebody a little responsibility and see what they can manage, and you just keep putting a little more on their plate mm-hmm. and they just keep knocking out of the park. Well, it came to the point where we had a number of foremen that had worked for us for a long time. One in particular was a friend of mine. Mm-hmm. Really hadn't performed amazingly. Mm-hmm. Had a conversation with him like, hey man, we're getting slow. We're coming down to it. Bro, you got to pick it up. Had the honest conversation with him. Mm-hmm. Okay, I got you, you know, just kind of shine me on. All right, cool. Mm-hmm. Well, it came down to decision day, and my boss came to me and said, all right, man, you've got some decisions to make. What do you think? And I told him, I go, look, man, there's no way I can look at this lead man who's mm-hmm. got a family and say, hey, I got to let you go because I'm friends with this guy. Mm-hmm. And that dude now, I have actually put on, we have reviews every year mm-hmm. that he's the next guy in line to take my position. And that guy has just knocked it out of the park on every job he's been to, every job he's done, big jobs, I mean, small jobs. He has just made money for us hand over fist. And we have a number of stories like that I could tell you that where we've had, it's come down to tough decisions, but these guys have made those decisions look really, really good because they've been eager to perform. They've been really appreciative of opportunity. So, you know, decisions are not always easy, mm-hmm. but some of the toughest decisions that are to be made are some of the most rewarding as well.
So I think a message that I just got from this little sermon of yours is don't ever think your work, whether it be good, is unnoticed, or whether it be bad, is not going to be noticed.
At least that's what we try and live by.
Yeah.
Now, I think there's a lot of value in that. And I would say that a lot of our team feels that way. You know, I feel like that the guys we have working with us on our team feel like that they will be properly recognized for the quality of job that they do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I also feel like that if some of the guys don't do a good job,
they will be properly recognized.
Yeah. That will be a tough conversation. Those are never easy. Those are never fun, but they are necessary.
Right.
And I think, quite honestly, it keeps the honest people honest. You know, keeps guys doing a good job. It keeps guys wanting to perform and do well. Quite honestly, it also, I think, preaches to the guys that are doing well,
mm-hmm.
that the guys that aren't doing well are going to be held accountable. You know, and I think that only breeds confidence within your own team.
So accountability is a huge thing. Huge. And this is something that the American people are striving for right now. it doesn't matter what side of the aisle you're on.
Yeah.
I'm sure everybody appreciates accountability, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of the reasons why our nation...
Not everybody. Everybody doesn't appreciate accountability. But everybody should.
Everybody should. 100%. Everybody should appreciate accountability. Yeah. Even if sometimes it hurts themselves, because if you're honest with yourself, you know you know you should be doing better, or you screwed up, or whatever it is, you know.
Ownership and accountability is a tough thing to find right now.
Ownership and how do you teach something like that? Like, how do you develop? You know what I noticed about my kids? Your kids are older now, so I don't know if you remember this specifically, but my kids are 6, 5, 3, and 1.
You guys done? You guys have more?
Only the good Lord knows.
What's the desire in your heart? You want more?
Bro, honestly, like, especially sometimes we'll look at them and we're like having dinner or something. And I tell my wife, I'm like, dude, look at these stinking cuties. They're all so smart. Like, how could you
not? Thank God for your wife, my man.
Dude, amen. She is an amazing woman.
Yeah.
Thank God for my wife. Thank God that I can support the fact that she can raise them.
Yeah.
You know, just a lot of blessings. I feel like I'm living on the blessings of my ancestors. And I think it's our responsibility, our generation, to continue one praying and preaching to the younger generation, to kind of develop values, develop skills, develop valuing values. I know valuing values sounds funny, right?
Yeah.
But valuing values is huge, because I don't know if I'm confusing you or if I can explain this correctly, but when you stop valuing values, when you don't have value, when you just kind of wake up in the morning and do whatever, yeah, you might have a job, you might be good at your job.
Yeah.
But do you have an opinion about this? Why is it important to have to value something? Or to have value? Because, like, personally for me, if you have a value to life, if you have a value to integrity, value to trust, if you appreciate these things, then you can be a person that develops these things. If you don't value them, I mean, prison won't teach you these things. That's for damn sure.
So you have more kids?
I don't know yet.
Just kidding.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think showing.
He said, so you have more kids.
I think that, you know, everybody values something.
Yeah.
Right. I think valuing,
I know you're stuttering and I was stuttering, but this is like a very, this is a topic and we're not philosophers and whatever else.
I think we're going to have a strong edit portion of this, conversation.
This is going to be as raw as possible.
Everybody holds a different
set of values,
level of value in certain things.
Okay.
You know, so my opinion is, you know, your set of values may be what's valuable to me may be a little bit different than what's valuable to you,
right?
And so I think appreciating one's values is, you know, very important. You know, and that's, you know, just to kind of refer back to what I was talking about my kids is, you know, instilling in them and being strong in what they believe in, you know, their core principles, biblical principles, you know, ownership, accountability, you know, those types of things. Mm-hmm. Those are values that I cherish. Mm-hmm. I can respect people that have a strong core value system. Mm-hmm. And that's, again, what I referred to, like friends in my circle have a strong core value system. Mm-hmm. You know, it's extreme. That's valuable to me. I'm very careful with who I quite honestly surround myself with. Can I trust you? Can I take you at your word? Mm-hmm. Can I trust the fact that, you know, when I turn my back, you're going to speak good of me, or at least not talk bad of me?
Or if you do have something bad to say, say it to my face.
Absolutely. Yeah. Are you going to be honest to me, to my face?
Yeah.
And so that's valuable to me. To some other people, they might not hold any value to that at all. But those are things that are valuable to me. And those are the things that we've tried to pass on to our children. And, you know, I don't think there is enough time to discuss where we're at today as a nation.
It's sad. It's sad. Honestly, it's kind of sad to look at the great America that I've become a citizen for now 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
So super proud.
Well done.
That.
Well done.
Thank you, sir. It was a long time coming.
Did it the right way?
Yes. Legally and all, everything else. But you know, when my grandparents were coming to this country, they imagined, like, I was in Ukraine 5 years ago and I met people that thought there was no dust here.
Wow.
It's not a joke. Like, that's how highly people think of America and Americans around the world. That's how highly they think of, like, the values of America and Americans.
Yeah.
You know, the things that America stands for, the principles of not just, even though we both share biblical principles, but not the principles of humanity that America stands for, you know?
Yeah.
And unfortunately, these past few years have shown a different side. But then at the same time, I think that helps us as Americans to kind of reflect upon ourselves and build relationships like we were just talking about. Family, relationships in the family, relationships at work, but now relationships as citizens.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that goes such a long way. And we've seen, I'm sure both of us have seen too many videos of citizens not building relationships and just ruining one, their own lives, and then the lives of their children.
Yeah.
You know, the lives of the future of this great nation.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that obviously we know that that's a deep pool to dive in, to discuss. I think one of the things that has gone on, is we have been given the impression or fed the impression that we have a lot less in common than we really do. And it's the divisiveness that has been created in really, quite honestly, I think is not the truth.
Mm-hmm.
I think all in all, I still think it's a great nation. Mm-hmm. I still think, you know, it's obviously got its faults,
mm-hmm.
you know, but I think, man, where we have been convinced that you have to agree with somebody at mm-hmm. all times.
Right.
And I think that's one of the biggest lies perpetuated ever. We all come from different backgrounds. We all have different life experiences. We all have, you know, different families and upbringings and, you know, and the inability to be a good listener and the inability to have empathy with where somebody else is coming from or hear somebody else's point of view has mm-hmm. been a problem.
Yeah.
You know, and I still hold out hope. I still think that we are on the verge of some really great things. And I think that we have a lot more in common than we've been led to believe.
In conclusion, what I noticed is what helps develop a culture in a company. I'll give them credit, is the HR department. You know, because of, and you might laugh at them, and if you watch The Office, Toby isn't your favorite character.
There's never been a better show created.
100% hands down, I agreed. You can learn so much from that show.
Absolutely.
Dude. And
question is, would that show be around today?
Probably not. I mean, it is now, but it would never be created today.
Right. It would offend too many people.
Yeah.
But that's a great thing about that show, is it leaves nobody out from being offended.
It's super inclusive.
Absolutely.
Includes everybody with their faults.
Absolutely.
Everybody with their strengths, with their...
It offends everybody. It offends everybody. Everybody should have equal opportunity to be offended.
Yes.
That's what makes it so great.
See, it offends, but also calls out. So, like, offended is almost a word, like, where if I'm offended by something, then maybe I should check myself. Like, it's not always, whoever offends me might not always be right.
Absolutely.
But just, like, check myself. Is my ego too big to be offended by something this stupid?
Oh, man.
You know, like...
Absolutely.
That's kind of how it is, but I feel like the United States, if we had an HR department, I have no idea how this would, because I would never trust the government to run an HR department. but the culture, you know, we always try to work on a culture in a company.
Mm-hmm.
And every company tries, the bigger the company, the more they focus on building a culture. And unfortunately, Hollywood's been building the culture here in the United States. They have the biggest reach into the homes of people through TV, through radio, through whatever, music. And I feel like we had a lot of diversity in America everywhere, maybe, and diversity in values and everything, except maybe Hollywood, because they try to put, because it's always about the money making, right? What's making most of the money? And growing up, obviously, this is a long conclusion, dude.
It's your show, my man.
This is a long conclusion. I'll see you guys in a part two. And this is my more conservative side speaking, but I feel like if we weren't stuffing our kids' faces with so much, like, sexualizing the culture and all this nonsense that doesn't actually develop them emotionally, physically, with the food, and just with everything, dude. I just feel like our culture feeds our kids so much garbage. And people like yourself, and I'm being honest, like, I'm sure the men that work with you can appreciate your honesty and the fact that sometimes, here's another thing of honest, sometimes when I'm in a tough situation in a relationship, I like to think, like, how would Josh react? How would Josh react right here? Because from someone looking in, he might think, oh, Josh is acting sly or whatever. But sometimes you have to be that sly person that will just listen. And sly, not in the bad sense of the word, but I guess wise would be a better word. Listen and then don't give your answer right away. Keep your mouth shut. Wait till the morning, sleep on it or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, and so teaching our kids that, dude, it hurts me so bad when you see a person like yourself, 41 years old, and they have no intelligence, emotional stability. They have no ability to build a relationship with somebody. And I think this is why Jordan Peterson is hated so much at this time. Is because he is promoting or nurturing those types of behaviors, like, hey, accountability, responsibility, all those types of things.
Yeah.
No excuses for your failures.
Yeah.
No excuses for why you haven't accomplished something. You probably didn't want to, you know?
Absolutely.
And so I hope this is an encouragement to everybody listening and watching, to work on themselves, develop themselves. It doesn't matter where you are. And obviously we learned today that in construction, you know, a lot of people think construction people are a bunch of crazy crackheads, but in construction.
And we are. And there's a lot of truth to that.
Yes, there is many of those. But at the same time,
the key is harnessing all of that.
Everything you have, the entire family, yeah, bring them together.
Absolutely.
Work on each other, build each other up instead of put each other down. And that goes into your family, your work environment, your country, like we talked, you know, yeah, as citizens, and respecting the people that aren't citizens yet, you know, because sometimes I like to look down on the ones that aren't citizens.
Easy, my man.
But because of my American pride, I'm joking. but it goes everywhere.
Yeah, that number one, I appreciate you saying that. I mean, yeah, that's extremely, that means a lot coming from you. You know, I have the highest regard, mm-hmm, you know, for you and, you know, your character. And I remember, man, you know, you being an apprentice talking about how you want to start a podcast and look, really? At you, and here you are. Absolutely. I remember some of those conversations. And, you know, I think that is one great thing, one of many great things about, you know, this country is, mm-hmm, it really is an opportunistic land. If you want it, go do it. Mm-hmm. Go get it. I mean, I'm sitting behind a mic, you know, on your podcast.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it was something that you envisioned, you made happen because you wanted it to happen. You know, and I think if you want something bad enough, you'll make it happen. You'll go get it.
Don't wait till, hey, I got to lose a couple pounds to start, or hey, I'm going to start January 1st. Cause that's when,
man,
we make so many excuses for our own selves.
You know? Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. You know, and I've been on my own fitness and health journey the past year, and
looking good,
bro. Man, and I appreciate that. Yeah. I'll take that. But man, there was many times where I could come up with every excuse in the book. And
why,
man,
you deserve that cupcake.
Oh, absolutely. Man, and I remember coming home from the gym like the first couple weeks, and my daughter would make a fresh batch of brownies. Dad made brownies. I'm like, oh my gosh. You know, and I'd have to just go shower up and go to bed just to avoid a brownie.
Yeah.
You know, but all that being said, man, you know, I'm stoked for you. You know, you got your own podcast, you're doing your thing, you got the, mm-hmm, right personality for it.
Thank you.
And again, man, I appreciate you having me on. It's been great conversation.
Likewise. Likewise. You know, thank you for coming on.
And absolutely.
Maybe sometime in the future we'll do it again with we'll extend a couple mics and, you know, have a couple more variables in the conversation.
That'd be a good time. I mean, I don't know if you've ever done like a multiplayer game, but I think that'd be cool, like a round table.
Round table, yeah.
You know, that'd be legit too.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. All righty, thank you.
Absolutely, thank you.